Hello, I'm Ty Mason from the diabetescouncil.com, researcher, writer, and I have type 2 diabetes. Today, I want to give you some sick day rules for managing your diabetes. After you watch the video today, I invite you to check out the description box for my new ebook. This is one of the most comprehensive diabetes meal planning books you'll find anywhere. It contains diabetes-friendly meals and recipes, recipes for different goals such as 800 to 1800 calories per day meal plans, diabetes meal planning tips and tricks, and there are also tons of diabetes-friendly recipes for everyone. Your body goes through some weird things sometimes when you are ill. One of the ways your body fights infection is to boost levels of stress hormones, which in turn can drive your blood sugar up. Then, in an effort to get rid of some of the offending diseases, the body decides that vomiting or diarrhea is a good way to rid the system of certain bacteria and germs. Now, this can do several things. It will cause us to not want to eat, and what food we do keep down is slow to absorb, and our blood sugar often plummets. To handle these diabetes control challenges, experts recommend following sick day rules to ensure blood glucose levels stay safe and put you on the road to recovery. The first thing that I would advise you to do is to check. Each person is different, especially when it comes to how the body responds to illness. Some patients are completely unaffected by sickness, while others are sensitive to a wide variety of illnesses. Rachelle Gandica, an MD and a pediatric endocrinologist at the Columbia University Medical Center, says that each type of illness can affect a person's blood glucose differently. It's important for insulin users to check blood glucose every 2 to 3 hours when sick. Even non-insulin users should check more often than usual, says Gandica. A good rule of thumb is to check your blood glucose every 2 to 3 hours regardless. Medicate. You need to keep taking your medications while sick, though perhaps you need to do so with some dose adjustments to compensate for high blood glucose levels or to avoid low blood glucose if you can't eat. It is best to discuss exactly what your adjustment should be with your healthcare provider, but there are some general guidelines. According to David Dugdale, who is a doctor and professor of medicine at the University of Washington, a rule of thumb to continue taking basal and bolus insulin. But recognize that if you don't eat, you wouldn't take a bolus. Basal or long-acting insulin is needed throughout illness, and you may need more than usual. Now, for ill people with type 2 diabetes, the insulin recommendations are the same as for type 1, but figuring out what to do about oral medications may actually be harder, says Dugdale. They may take pills that are designed to offset what they eat, and there is no formula for that, he says. Some of the pills should be adjusted if people are sick enough that they can't eat. For example, you may need to reduce your metformin because the medication can increase the risk of hypoglycemia. People with type 2 using metformin may need to switch to insulin during a serious illness, such as gastrointestinal flu, because dehydration and the decreased kidney function may result in increased the risk for a rare complication, lactic acidosis, that's associated with metformin use. Now, Dugdale suggests asking your doctor if you should take a break from any of your medications while ill. It just adds another set of variables that might make it hard to do the right thing. Another thing you need to check, and this is very important, are your ketones. One of the most serious risks of sickness in people with diabetes is diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, this is a life-threatening condition caused by too little insulin in the body in combination with stress hormones associated with the illness. You need to check your urine ketones frequently while you're sick. Urine ketones are indicated on a test strip as trace, low, moderate, high, and very high. Dugdale says any amount should be noted and reported to your doctor. If it's more than low, the patient should get specific instructions on how to turn things around and may need to get intravenous medication. Now, check with your own healthcare provider for how to deal with high ketones and make a plan for when levels don't come down. For parents of infants, you need to put some cotton balls in your diaper, and then when the child voids, you can squeeze the cotton ball out onto a urine ketone strip. You always need to hydrate. Dehydration is a risk factor for diabetic ketoacidosis, so it's critical to stay well hydrated while ill. A cup of fluid every hour should be enough, but keep in mind that vomiting and diarrhea increase the risk of dehydration. Dugdale recommends carbohydrate-free fluids, such as water, to help keep blood glucose levels from rising too high. He says, I've seen people with diabetic ketoacidosis who kept drinking sugary fluids without recognizing how much sugar they were taking, which just aggravated their blood sugar. If they take fluids with sugar, they need to account for that in some way, says Dugdale. Now, for people who are sick to their stomach and not eating, the rule of thumb can be bent in order to take in some nourishment. In that situation, you probably ought to take some sugar-free and sugary fluids alternating back and forth, and if drinking is making you nauseous, then try some popsicles. You need to check the over-the-counter medication labels that you're taking. Most OTC cold and flu medications are generally safe for people with diabetes, but people with kidney problems may have certain restrictions. Always check with the doctor before you take an OTC to make sure it is safe and doesn't react with any of your prescription medications for diabetes or other conditions. You can also check with your pharmacist. You need to know when to get help. If you have ketones, high blood glucose, or both, and you can't get them to come down, especially if you're using insulin, that all merits a call to the doctor's office. If you or your child has signs or symptoms of diabetic ketoacidosis, it's time to visit the emergency room. Being sick increases your risk for developing this disease, and you need to keep an eye out for those symptoms when sick and go to the emergency room if you suspect diabetic ketoacidosis. Now, let me give you the early signs. Thirst or very dry mouth, frequent urination, high blood glucose levels, typically over 250, and high levels of ketone in your urine or blood. Later on, symptoms will include constantly feeling tired, dry or flushed skin, nausea, vomiting, or abdominal pain, difficulty breathing, a fruity odor on the breath, and a hard time paying attention or being confused. While this is not a comprehensive discussion on the topic, I hope we have covered the basics. For a very in-depth and complete discussion of this topic, I invite you to visit thediabetescouncil.com. Leanne has done a wonderful job on this topic, and she has a very extensive article that I think would be very important for you to read, and some good stuff there for you to know that I have not covered in this video. Don't forget to get my new ebook, like this video, and subscribe to our channel so we can continue to bring you informative videos like this one in the future. I want to thank you so much for watching. I'm Ty Mason.